day for all you people of France to know that you can come back to Paris. And we hope that soon this war will be over. All we Americans will return to...
In 1945, just after the liberation of Paris, but before the end of World War II, the Paris fashion industry created a unique exhibition of 200 wire figurines clothed in the latest couture fashions and displayed in miniature theater sets. It was called the Théâtre de la Mode, the theater of fashion. It is the story of Paris recovering its role as a fashion capital, of France rebuilding from the debris of war, and of industry and artists working together to create a touching and poetic symbol of hope and renewal. It is a window to the past, revealing a social landscape now gone. For centuries, Paris has nourished the world with great literature and art, and of course, fashions. By the 18th century, Paris dressmakers were clothing fashionable women from Europe to the Americas. Paris had become, as it still remains, the capital of fashion.
By sending dolls throughout the world, the first artisans of French fashion acquainted foreign countries with French taste and skill. We were really the first exporters of the idea of fashion for women. There was an idea that style, ambiance, everything originated only in Paris. Even foreign designers came to Paris for their baptism, so to speak. Is it because of the architecture in Paris? Because of Parisian women? Well, fashion comes from Paris. About that, there is no doubt. Perhaps women in Paris have a special flair. They're more diverse. They have a talent for creating their own personal style. It's possibly this ability which French women have more than others. In Paris, a woman interprets contemporary fashion in her own way.
I don't know, but I think that Paris has a certain light. And then everything in Paris is beautiful. I believe this inspires designers to create lovely things. There is surely a magic potion in Paris, because all the foreign designers who have come to Paris remain in the end, and they open their own couture houses.
In the mid-19th century, Paris fashion influence was enhanced by a new system for creating elegant clothes when English-born Charles Frederick Worth developed what we now call haute couture. Worth designed an entire collection of dresses. Then, perhaps for the first time, the dresses were presented to prospective clients on a live mannequin. After selection, the dresses were made to order for each individual customer. That tradition continues today. The hallmark of haute couture, and one of the reasons for its cost, is a superb hand craftsmanship and attention to detail. Not only in the atelier or workrooms of the couture house, but also in the scores of workshops throughout Paris which provide accessories.
There is something magic about Paris, inexplicable. You find yourself in a center where everything you need is brought to you with the utmost speed and efficiency, as though by a magic wand. There you are, button makers bring you buttons, feather craftsmen feathers, everything is there to assist you. And what gives Paris its strength as capital of fashion is not only the great designers like Yves Saint Laurent, but everything which surrounds them, those great artisans, the accessory makers. And these accessories give to Paris fashion its very special and subtle flavor.
Fashions change in response to changing times. The couturier as designer must sense the future and capture the moment if he or she wishes to create clothes which women will want to wear. In the mirror of fashion history, we see not only the form of clothes, but a reflection of the times. Thus, fashion helps to reveal the forces that shape society. By the 1930s, haute couture was synonymous with Paris, and fashion was an integral part of Parisian life. Paris itself had become a theater of fashion, its streets and monuments, the stage for a continuously changing performance. Fashionable women came to Paris to see and to be seen.
I believe that haute couture is really like a theater, in that the women we dress cannot be dressed as they are in ready-to-wear. These women play a certain role, and they come to us to be dressed for their role. When you make one dress, one time for a particular woman, it's like a costume for a play. I think that's the real mission of the couturier.
Parisians appreciated the showing of a new collection of fashions at a haute couture house as much as they appreciated the opening of a new play or ballet. Ballerina and actress Leslie Caron explains how the French designers premiered their collections at an exclusive event the French call the défilé.
The event of défilés in the fashion houses were photographed, sketched, talked about. It was a great event in the life of the city. The défilés of fashion were very, very different. I remember going with my mother to the défilé of Dior. The fashion show lasted at least a month, every single day.
5 o'clock cocktails at the Ritz call for Rage of Paris, done in black velvet.
And then it little by little sipped through to the big public. You could buy the model and you could cut it at home, or your little dressmaker could make the dress. And in those days, everybody had a dressmaker.
In the years before World War II, fashionable women from 6 continents bought their made-to-measure clothes from the famous haute couture houses of Paris. Fashionable women who could not afford haute couture had copies made by their local dressmaker. American manufacturers translated Paris originals into ready-to-wear outfits. Thus, the couture fashions designed in Paris for a few thousand privileged women inspired the clothes worn by millions worldwide. Fashion was big business. By 1939, the French fashion industry, including couture houses, accessory makers, and textile manufacturers, employed more than 900,000 men and women. It was the second largest French industry and played a key role in exports and the French economy. On September